Hi everybody, and thank you for the opportunity to present my work. I'm Mariana Gallo. I'm a PhD student at the University of Turin, and I work with Luis Torero, and I collaborate with Diaferio, Chakrabarty, and De Bagezio on a way to constrain the shape of a Milky Way dark matter halo with hypervelocity stars. So let's start. We know that the lambda cold dark matter scenario predicts the existence of dark matter halos surrounding the Milky Way and the other external galaxies. From collisionless and body simulations, we have that the dark matter halo is predicted to be triaxial or near prolate. And if we add the effects of baryonic matter, we find that the dark matter halo is predicted to be more oblate at the center and then more triaxial intermediate radii and prolate at larger distances from the galactic center. However, from observational constraints with halo stars and tidal streams as tracers, we didn't find univocal results for our Milky Way. So in our work, we will use hypervelocity stars as tracers of the dark matter halo density profile. The existence of such stars was predicted by Hills in 1988. He predicted that an hypervelocity star is ejected after an interaction between a stellar binary system and the supermassive black hole located at the center of our galaxy. When the stellar binary had a closed pericenter passage near the supermassive black hole, it can be disrupted and one star is captured by the black hole and the other one is ejected as hypervelocity star with a very high speed. The existence of such stars was confirmed by Brown et al. In 2005, and then other observation follows. And nowadays we have a current sample of around 20 hypervelocity stars located in the halo. Since the stars are ejected at the galactic center but are observed in the outer halo, they are a powerful tool to constrain the Milky Way gravitational potential. And our work will use a statistical approach. So we will investigate the constraining power of a sample of hypervelocity stars on the Milky Way dark matter halo shape. To do so, we develop a code that integrates HVS trajectories across the Milky Way halo. We first generate a distribution of ejection velocity according to the Hills mechanism, and the figure shows our results for the chosen parameter in our simulation. The hypervelocity star is ejected in a pure radial direction, but then the trajectories are bent during the travel of the star through the Milky Way gravitational potential, and the star acquires also a non-null V theta and V phi component for the velocity. We choose to modelize our gravitational potential with the sum of the contribution of the supermassive black hole, of the spherical Ehrenquist bulge, of the Miyamoto-Nagai disk, which is axis symmetric with respect to the z-axis, and with the triaxial dark matter halo, in which the degree of triaxiality depends on the axis ratios Qy and Qz, that are the flattening or the elongation along the y and z axis. And finally, through our numerical code, we generate HVS mock catalogs for different shape of the dark matter halo, so for different axis ratios. We obtain a final sample of around 800 stars with positive radial velocities and located at more than 10 kiloparsec from the galactic center. And for each star in our mock catalogs, we show the velocity and the position in both the galactocentric and heliocentric reference plane. So now our analysis can start, and we want to investigate the impact of a change in the dark matter halo shape on the distribution of HVS's phase space coordinates. So hereafter, I will consider the simpler spheroidal dark matter halo case, so Qy is fixed equal to 1. We use the mock catalogs generated in the spherical case and in the two more extreme oblate and prolate scenarios we are investigating. And at this stage, we keep the initial condition fixed since we are interested in the impact of a change only in the dark matter halo shape. So we use a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test to compare the distribution of all the physical quantities we have in our mock catalogs for the spherical and the oblate, and for the spherical and the prolate cases. The null hypothesis of the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test is that the two distributions we are comparing are compatible, so are drawn from the same mother distribution. And we find that only the galactocentric tangential velocity enable us to distinguish a spherical from a prolate or a spherical from an oblate Dermatter halo with a high significance level. Of course, we are in the spheroidal case, so only V theta will be different from zero, while the distribution of V phi will be null. So the plot shows the distribution of V theta, and we can see how the yellow histograms that are the distribution that we obtain in the oblate scenario as a median V theta that is higher with respect to that that we obtain in the spherical or in the prolate case, that is the blue histogram. And this is simply explained by the fact that the bending on the trajectories induced by the disk act in the same way of that induced by the Dermatter halo when we are in the oblate scenario, while in the prolate scenario, the bending of the disk and on the Dermatter halo are opposite. So now we want to use HVS V theta distributions to recover the shape of the Dermatter halo through which hypervelocity stars have traveled. To do so, we need one synthetic sample of HVSs generated in a non-gravitational potential, and this will be replaced with real data. And then we need a reference set of mock catalogs generated for each axis ratios we are investigating. And for each QZ, we generate 5,000 different sets of initial conditions. So our method works like this. For each QZ value, we compare our synthetic sample with the HVS catalogs by mean of the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. And so for each axis ratio we are investigating, we obtain a distribution of 5,000 p-value. Then we employ the property of the p-value, according to which under the null hypothesis, so when the two distributions we are comparing are compatible, the p-value is uniformly distributed over the interval 0, 1. And so, the QZ for which we obtain a uniform distribution of p-values and the largest median p-value that will be of around 0.5 will correspond to the scenario that is compatible with our synthetic sample of HVS. And here I show an example of the reliability of our method for a synthetic sample generated in a Dermatter halo with QZ equal to 1. So, if we compare this synthetic sample generated in a spherical Dermatter halo with our mock catalogs generated with QZ equal to 1, we can see from the left plot that we recover the uniform distribution of p-values, which is the gray histogram, while if we compare it with the mock catalogs generated for QZ equal to 0.9 or to 1.1, we can't recover the uniform distribution and the median p-value will be a lot smaller. And we can see from the right plot, if we do the comparison also for all the other axis ratio we are investigating, that the median p-value of the distribution becomes smaller and smaller as we reach higher prolate or oblate scenarios. So our method is reliable and has a success rate of around 95%. Of course, we have obtained these results for our synthetic sample of hypervelocity stars that includes around 800 stars. But how does the HVS sample size affect the success rate of our method? And to answer this question, we can look at this plot. And nowadays we have observed around 20 hypervelocity stars. And we can see that for few 10 stars in our sample, the success rate goes under the 50%. However, for 200 stars, we can reach a success rate that is greater of 70%. So to conclude, we add that our method recovers the correct shape of a spheroidal Dermatter halo in 95% of cases, starting from the Vitita distribution of a sample of around 800 stars. The number of HVSs in the sample sets the success rate of our method, of course, but looking at future prospects, we have that the identification of new HVS candidates, either in the Gaia catalog or in future surveys, will enable us to put tighter constraints on the Milky Way dark matter halo shape. Thanks for your attention.